Yes, thank you very much, Fidel. Today, one way that we could title this event is, if you wanted to in a broad way, we could call it From Dishwasher to CEO. Because the story we're going to hear about is an entrepreneur who actually started doing one of the most menial jobs that we talk about. There are a lot of us who are graduating, who are recently graduated, who are thinking about how are we going to start a business or how do we get into the corporate world. And Fidel's story is really going to show you that it's a great place to start is at the bottom. And I want to really start off our conversation tonight. Fidel is now considered in the forefront of the food practices. He's done some amazing sustainable initiatives, and we'll get to that in a bit. But really, my first question for you, Fidel, is what made you want to really change the cafeteria world, if you will?
Okay. Well, first of all, I'm used to doing a PowerPoint and a presentation, so this kind of actor's studio thing is kind of cool. So I didn't have to prepare anything, I guess I could just chat.
That's great.
So that's a true story. I did wash dishes at the University of Portland, and a couple of years after that, Father Walshman, who was the president at that time, gave me the keys and said, "You're running it." The manager quit, and I didn't know what the hell I was doing, but somehow I faked it. If I take you back to, well, first of all, let me tell you that I did not start this company right out of college. I worked for a major public company, and I was co-president of that company, which was over $1 billion, a New York Stock Exchange company, and learned as much as I could about the industry. And once I understood the industry, I always had in the back of my mind this dream that I wanted to start my own company. So the good news was, at least I understood the industry and the space I was going to get into, which I think for anybody to be an entrepreneur, that's really, really important. But if I take you back to when we started in 1986, I was, in understanding the industry, I was very upset about what was going on in terms of quality food, food that was authentic, fresh, seasonal. You all heard the term mystery meat, and those people that were working in corporate America had lousy food. Those people on college and university campuses had lousy food, and I thought there's got to be a better way. I was always a food nut, and I wanted to create something different, and I wanted to create change in an industry that I knew, and since I knew a lot of the competitors, I wanted to do something very, very different so I could make a significant difference in an industry that I loved. So that was the beginning of it. That's how it started.
Now, that moves us into one of your most well-known initiatives, which is the Farm to Fork. Where did that idea come from?
So, and I apologize a little bit for my hoarse voice because I had a cold the last couple of days, but when I started this company, I wanted to create a restaurant company in what we call the contract environment, to take the risk out of building 10,000 square foot restaurants and leasing them for 20 years. I felt that if I could deliver great food, great tasting food in this environment, I'd have this wonderful little niche of a company in San Francisco. I'd never have to get on a plane again, and it would be kind of cool. And my little Italian roots would come out, and I'd feel really good about all that. Didn't quite happen that way, but so taste and flavor and fresh food was critically important to me. And early on, after a year or so, I felt that, well, let me back up. I also felt that I wanted to bring really great, talented chefs into this part of the industry, which nobody was doing at that point in time. The industry was trying to get rid of labor in the kitchens by adding products like sous vide, where you would take product and you would freeze it, and they were getting rid of labor, and you could get rid of the major expense. And I wanted to go the other way, to do fresh food with chefs and bring chefs into this industry and into this part of the industry. And I knew that if, in order to attract those chefs, because this was not the glamorous part of the industry, I would have to give them free rein, if you will, to go out and find and source the best products. I knew in order to do that, we had to talk to local farmers and ranchers. So early on, I challenged them to go in the fields close to where our kitchens were. And this was in California then, because it was easier in California, although it's fairly easy here too now, to go work with farmers and ranchers to go source as much local product as possible. And my rule at that point was 150 miles from the kitchen. When we went to the farm, well, and I also felt that, you know, we could get, we were getting apples in cold storage and we'd get them 3 months later, or tomatoes never tasted the same. And so I, that's what I forced them to go in the field. So that started, we coined the word farm to fork before it was even coined at that point. And it all started with taste. When I went to those ranchers and farmers, they laughed at us, saying, when I said, I'll buy all the arugula that you could grow, they said, how do I know you're gonna pay me? And how do I know you're gonna really buy all this product? So that took a while to gain that trust. So that started this whole thing about farm to fork. And it got me to think about how I could become more of a unique, distinctive company. The word sustainability wasn't even in there at that point. And how do I tie a ribbon around this from a brand standpoint? And as we started to get more farm to fork products, I recognized the chefs got more excited and they were working with the farmers and their fields, and they cared about the soil and the land and those people that were harvesting your agriculture, and it started to take off that way. And that led to this whole issue of sustainability in my mind, that we were going to create and make something unique out of that.
Well, obviously you went on, your timeline talks about a variety of principles that you brought in. You created ideas of practices that would include cage animals. You brought in what I find very important, a code of ethics even, a code of conduct that was shared with some of these suppliers. When you, over the years, going into the early 2000s, did you find that you were getting that same pushback that you initially did when you said, I'll buy all of your produce if you make it farm under the farm to fork model? But now when you start to say, we want sustainability in other matters, we want you to sign our code of conduct, we want you to pledge to these things, and we pledge to buy your product. Did you find that same pushback?
Yes, and I do today too. This was not easy. After the farm to fork, I partnered with the Monterey Bay Aquarium to look at seafood and to deal with the issues of species that were extinct, like Atlantic cod, the issues of farm salmon and how they're raised, and the lice that's on them, and the dye that's there, and what they do to the oceans and create dead zones. And I realized that there was a huge amount of issues in agriculture that I needed the science behind, so we started to partner with a number of NGOs, Environmental Defense, National Resources Defense Council, the Humane Society, on, to get the science behind what we were trying to do. And I thought to myself, that's the ticket to make a difference in the industry. I could change the industry by doing something, and I could create this bow, if you will, or this ribbon to be the most sustainable food service company in America. And that was my huge challenge at that point, to go do that. And so we started with 1992, we were the first company to do cage-free, humane certified certified eggs. Then I was asked to serve on the Pew Commission for industrial farm animal production for 3 years. And we toured every concentrated animal feeding operation in the United States practically. So I looked at how chickens were raised and how swine was raised and how cattle was raised and the horrible issues of gestation crates with pork and battery cages with chickens that live their whole life with 8.5 by 11 on a sheet of paper, can't move. All of those issues caused me to say, we're gonna do something completely different. The problem I had was trying to source, as we grew, and today we're over 700 million, you can, if we're 700 million, then I spend about 350 million in spend, if you will, and 40% of that is what we call farm to fork, because I can't buy enough. But I pledged early on that all of our protein was gonna come from non-therapeutic antibiotics protein. That's the, those are animals that are shot up with hormones so that they go to market. There's an economic advantage for them to go to market quicker, but they're all full of hormones. And when you're ingesting those hormones and you really need those antibiotics, they're not gonna do you any damn good. So I pledged early on that I was gonna deal with this. I could not deal with it with pork. I did it with poultry, and as I fought Tyson and some of the larger chicken facilities, they said, no, we can't do that. That's not our model. And I was trying to build an ecological model of agriculture instead of what was going on. So we had to source from block, we had to go find ranchers and chicken producers and cattle producers that would give us this product. And everybody fought us. Just recently, last week, I announced a new animal welfare pledge that I would buy all of our pork by 2015 without gestation crates. That's a huge issue in terms of the industry. And I had all kinds of feedback from Smithfield and Cargill and Monsanto and the big boys saying, you're gonna ruin the industry and all that kind of stuff. But I don't really give a damn because that's what we're gonna do. So.
That leads to a question that I have, and you've made these initiatives over time after time, and they've been incredibly successful. But obviously, for any entrepreneur who's really driving their company in a direction based on a principle or a mission, whatever it may be, what are the fears that you've felt over the years, and what were the largest sources of that fear for you?
I don't think I had any major fears except for running out of money at the beginning. I mean, I will tell you that whatever you decide to do and whatever mission or strategic plan or dream that you put down on a piece of paper and you run all your numbers on your spreadsheet, you're gonna need three times as much money as you think you're gonna need. It's true. I almost went bankrupt the first 5 years. I had to go back to the well and give it all away to investors. There's never enough cash, and cash is king. Forget profits. Cash is the king when you're starting a company. I think fear of failure was the thing that I was not going to fail come hell or high water, and that drove me to work 24 hours a day, which you have to do as an entrepreneur if you're going to start a company. You got to live and breathe it. You can't just do it 8 hours a day. It doesn't work. But I said there's an opportunity here to make money and do good at the same time and bring something to a marketplace that was never done before. And more importantly, I knew that if the brand was strong, I will tell you that today we're close to $740 million as a company with 500 locations, and I've never had one salesperson in the company. It's all been built by the brand. And the brand, when you build a brand, it needs to be tightly focused. You can't be all things to all people. And you, as the CEO or the founder of that company, needs to control that brand. Otherwise, it's chaos. Everybody decides, we got another idea, we can go do this, we can do this. And if you're not focused and you don't stay strong on that brand and consistent, you're gonna fail. I can tell you that right now. So the brand was critically important, and it also created this emotional attachment to the marketplace with sustainability, and more importantly, an emotional attachment to the culture of the people that are in Bon Appétit. It's part of our DNA, and You can talk to any of our, we have over 12,000 employees. They get it, they understand it. And if I was to change my head tomorrow and go to the right instead of the left, they'd hang me. Because my people really believe with what we do. I mean, they really believe it.
Now, that leads to my next question. You bring up this great point of your people believing and your brand being your image. But you as an entrepreneur, you've taken on all this, you're working 24 hours a day. Who do you turn to as your confidant to help you answer those questions that you maybe have a second guess that you want someone else's opinion on? Who has that person been for you, or has it been a variety of people over the years?
I don't think I've ever had a real confidant. I think I'm blessed with really talented people that I'm surrounded with, and I think I rely on them a lot. My job is to set the direction and the vision and to hold the brand tightly, so it's tightly focused, and their job is to execute and deliver on the promises. And I'm lucky because I have a group of people that I'm surrounded with that are smarter than I am, and they get it, and they challenge me every single day. And I have learned a big lesson. I learned how to listen, which I think is important. But I think you need to surround you need to surround yourself with the very, very best. The best roaster, the best marketing person, the best finance person that can help you guide your vision of where you want to go. I think that's really important.
Absolutely. Now, can you take us from there to talk about, and it's your choice which you want to answer first, but what has been, in your opinion, based on your goals to yourself, what has been your biggest achievement, and yet what has been your biggest failure?
I think that since the company's known as a sustainable food service company, and we have changed the industry to some extent, we've changed a lot of things in the industry. We haven't changed enough yet, but I think that's, I feel really good about that. I think one of the things we did, and I might have told the story before, that I'm really proud of, that we never talk about in terms of agriculture and the issues that we have in this broken world of ours in terms of agriculture, are those people that harvest our lettuce and our strawberries and our food and our tomatoes. And I understand that there's a huge issue of immigration and undocumented workers and all of that. But a year and a half ago, or about 2 years now, I heard about an issue, and I heard it from a student. I was at Washington University in St. Louis, and a student raised their hand. I was giving a lecture on agriculture and public health, and she said to me, do you know what's going on in the fields in Immokalee, Florida with the tomatoes? And I said, no, I don't. I said, would you come in and talk to me afterwards? So she did, and told me about these issues that were in Florida with actual slavery and child abuse and sexual discrimination in the fields and safety in the fields, where we get most of our tomatoes in the wintertime, because you can't get farm to fork in the wintertime. You either get them at least east of the Mississippi, and we have a lot of business east of the Mississippi. They're picked green, and they're brought in warehouses and gassed, and that's what you eat in the wintertime. And if I didn't have to serve tomatoes, I wouldn't, but I have to in some cases. Anyway, in the wintertime. So it was either getting them from Florida or Mexico. We were getting them from Florida, and I didn't know what the issues were. So I flew down there, and I took a reporter with me from the Washington Post, who I knew, and I took a chef with me, and one of our people, and we went to Immokalee, Florida. Immokalee, Florida is about 35 miles from Fort Myers, which is a very rich community in Florida. 35 miles from this rich community where all these big houses are all the tomato fields, and there's this Hispanic town that's all run down, and you show up at 5 o'clock in the morning, and all these people are in a parking lot, and they get on buses, and they drive an hour, and they go to these fields. Well, they wouldn't let me in. I tried to talk to the to the coyote, who was the main person, and some of the growers. They wouldn't let me in. So we snuck into the fields, and we were in the fields for 3 days taking pictures. And the fellow that I had with me, the chef, spoke their language. So we got under the barbed wire, and then at night we went to their trailers and we ate tortillas and we talked to them. And I actually saw people locked up in trailers because they didn't work hard enough. And they were locked up, and they were there for 3-4 days before they were released. I saw issues of child abuse. I saw no shade in the heat. If they went to a bathroom, they had to walk a half a mile across a field to go to the bathroom, and it's all done by piecemeal. So they pick up buckets and they put them in they get 30 cents a bucket. And I actually did it myself to see how long it would take me to get 3, 4, 5 bucks. It takes forever, and it's backbreaking work. So the last day we wrote a code of conduct with the workers. And I brought the code of conduct to the growers. There's 4 huge growers down there, and said, I want you to sign this code of conduct, because if you don't, I'm not gonna buy any more tomatoes from you. And I learned that we bought, 6-7 million pounds of tomatoes in 4 months from these guys. I said, we're not gonna do that. If we do that, we'll change the whole industry. And the next thing we gotta do is we gotta worry about the radishes 3 miles down the road and the next crop and all that. I said, what you're doing is wrong. He said, it's not us, it's that coyote that we hired, the contractor. I said, it's your field and your tomatoes, and you hired the son of a bitch, so don't tell me it's not you. I'm not gonna do it. Okay, fine. So long story short, I got Whole Foods and I got Chipotle behind me, because they had a lot more purchasing power than I did, and we boycotted those growers, and we bought stuff from Mexico, or we didn't buy tomatoes for 4 months. And on every college campus that we served, and every corporation east of the Mississippi, we sent out flyers and notices of why we didn't serve tomatoes. They finally stepped up after 4 months and agreed to the code of conduct. And then I hired 4 university fellows that graduated that go around and just assess the ranches and the farms and all that. And they have been to Immokalee, Florida about 7 times to audit them to make sure that they follow that. We did change what was going on in the fields. When we finally did that, I felt really good about it, but then I realized that there was other issues. And I can tell you that I spent the next year, not full time, but occasionally going to farms, not only in Salinas, but in Oregon, in Washington, and in Ohio, to see how workers were being treated, those people that harvest their agriculture. And it's a total mess. It's broken, huge, and nobody's gonna do that work but them. So if you ask me what I'm the most proud of, the work's not done yet, but I'm most proud that at least we have created an assessment. We know it needs to be done, and hopefully we can fix that in the future for those people.
I want to make sure that some of the audience can ask you some questions, but I can't thank you enough. I should change the title of this from dishwasher to activist, but anyhow, I'm going to open it up for a few minutes to questions to everyone out there, and thank you, Fidel.
Yes.
Oh, hi. I'm familiar with how difficult it is to pass along costs to customers, and you start this Can you take us back to that first presentation where you were trying to get a customer to agree to, who knows, 40 or 50% increase in cost, because what you're doing is substantially more expensive than what was run of the mill, not only back then but today. It's extremely expensive. And the second part of that is, if you could comment on why your model is not worth in the service
delicatessen to
the world, where they've tried to do that for the last 15 to 20 years?
I did not start on college and university campuses, first of all. I started in corporate America. And I was very lucky early on. I met Larry Ellison, who's founded Oracle. And his dream was to create, this is before he started the company, was to create this company where he was competing for engineers and competing for people and trying to retain. And this was the beginning of Silicon Valley. So I was in the right place at the right time. What I did was say, what he was concerned about was, how do I attract really talented people to do what I want them to do? And one way to do that, and it was a selfish reason, one way to do that was to create really good food that was fresh and great, so they'd never have to leave campus and go drink 3 martini lunches, and they could work all day and all night, and you just feed them. It was that simple, selfish reason. And once Oracle got going, the other companies followed. It wasn't for about 2 or 3 years later that I said to myself, as I looked at the companies in Silicon Valley at that point, these were all young people that they were hiring, bright young people. They're coming out of college campuses. And I know that the food sucks over there. So why don't I go do that so that I get them when they're in college and I get them when they come back to Google? And that's what led me to the education business. When I went to it, the industry was so broken and the food was so bad, and it wasn't 40 to 50% more, it was about 20% more. It wasn't the cost of food, and it isn't the cost of food today. It's the cost of labor. It's the cost of using a French knife and doing things from scratch. Instead of using soup bases, you buy bones and you roast them and you make stock from scratch. That takes labor and takes time. So our costs are really in the labor part of it. It isn't so much the food. And in fact, these initiatives are now somewhat cost neutral. When we did cage-free eggs, it was prohibitive. It was very expensive. We were going to do it anyway. Now it's somewhat cost neutral. I'm not going to tell you that we don't spend a little bit more on food, because we do, but we try to take the middle person out by going directly to the farm or to the ranch. The problem that we have across the United States is distribution. There's not good distribution. How do we get it from the field to my back dock in 500 locations? I can do it with 1 or 2 restaurants. I can't do it there. The other thing that I think is very, very important is that the term organic is somewhat watered down now. It doesn't mean anything anymore. It's more important to me and our chefs that we buy local and we support the local communities. I'd rather buy an apple off a tree that comes 10 miles from here versus an organic apple that was in New Zealand and shipped by boat, and I get it 3 months later. So the local, if I can buy local and organic, that's great. But local is more important. And if you buy local, the farmer's market, and you support the communities in which you work, live, and play, to me, that's more important. And the taste is gonna be there. It's all about flavor. So yeah, it gets a little bit more expensive, but usually what we in the United States eat a lot of empty calories. And if you think about all of the issues, all of the externalities in terms of the agricultural mess that we're in, with the issues of the oceans, the issues of waste, the issues of the environment, the issues of concentrated animal feeding operations that impact rural communities, if you think about all those cleanup costs, and those are healthcare costs, which are billions of dollars, you're spending that money anyway. You're just spending it in a different way. And those of us in the United States, our food dollar spend of our disposable income is less than anybody else in the world. But we buy cheap calories. So the real question is, how do you tell a story to educate people? And believe me, I'm not against a hamburger. I love a hamburger. The question is, you don't need them 5 times a week, and you don't need a 32-ounce steak anymore. There was a priest at the University of Portland once, Father Dumb, who ate a 32-ounce steak at this where is that place out there?
Huh?
Yeah, that country kitchen thing. In fact, I bet him he won, but I lost. He's passed away since then, but.
No correlation, I'm sure.
Never mind, get that story. Anyway, yes, it's more expensive, but I believe it's healthier. I think it's the right thing to do. We have to learn how to deal with portions, and we need to learn how to eat differently with our diets and seasonal. And we also need to control the waste in the fields and the waste that we have in our kitchens. We throw, even in our home kitchens, 25% of what we grow in the United States is thrown out. What if we had that 25%? Think about all the people we could feed.
I'd like to take one more question, and then we're going to have to wrap up because we still have another event for the night. Yes.
When you first got started, was access to capital an issue for you?
Yeah. And it's the biggest stumbling block, I think, of any entrepreneur to start a company. Where do you find the cash and the people to invest to believe in you? Now, I was lucky because I was with a company for 20 years, a public company, and I knew people on our board, and I knew a lot about the industry. I went to those board members, and they had enough faith in me to. But don't kid yourself. I mortgaged everything, and you know I took a huge risk and didn't cash a paycheck for 3 years. I was lucky. I had a parachute with the other company, but as I said earlier, cash is king. And you gotta find, it's not, you just can't write a strategic plan. You gotta find people that are as passionate as you are about what you do and make them understand that you really are focused and you care a great deal about this business and you're gonna do something with it. The other issue is you better figure out an exit strategy. I sold my company twice in order to, because I felt I had a fiduciary responsibility to the shareholders to make sure they had an exit strategy to get the money that they wanted. So, I mean, it was kind of a weird thing, but we'll talk about that later.
Well, Fedele, thank you so much. Thanks for joining us, and thanks for all you do.